React hooks use features of the React framework by calling special hook functions from within a component. We can build static or dumb components in React by writing functions. However, UI components are often dynamic. They may need to change the state of their data, react to lifecycle events, access elements from the DOM, among many other things. But prior to React version 16.8, developers were required to write classes to take advantage of certain React features. Now you can still use classes in React, but hooks generally provide a more ergonomic way to build components because you can reuse stateful logic without changing your component hierarchy. React has 10 built-in hooks, and you'll understand what every single one of them does by the end of today's video. In addition, you'll learn how to build your own hooks from scratch, to extract your own component logic into reusable functions. If you're new here, like and subscribe, and consider becoming a pro member at Fireship.io to get access to my upcoming next Firebase course. If you're new to React, it's helpful to understand why hooks exist in the first place. In the past, stateful logic, or data that changes within the application, was tightly coupled to a class-based component. That means in order to work with reactive data, you needed to create a component. That seems reasonable, but what it led to in reality was a complex tree of nested components.
No, don't like that.
And this is where I have to admit that I used to really dislike React, because sharing any logic required some frustrating jujitsu like higher order components and render props, which are patterns that have you passing components as arguments to other components. And that just always felt way more complex to me than patterns you find in other frameworks like Angular. Fortunately, hooks changed everything by giving you access to lower level features of React outside of the context of a component. When you work with hooks, you can think of them like low-level primitives of the React framework that give you special abilities that you wouldn't otherwise have in vanilla JavaScript. The hooks themselves are functions which always start with the name of use, because you're using the superpowers of the React framework. Now, before you start using hooks, there's really just one rule you should be aware of, and that's to only call them at the top level of a functional component. They don't work inside of regular JavaScript functions, nested functions, loops, or anything like that. The only exception to this rule is when building your own custom hooks, which we'll look at towards the end of the video. Now the question becomes, what do these primitives or hooks actually do? Let's break them down one by one, starting with useState. useState is easily the most important and often used hook. To import it in your React app, type use into the IDE, and that should give you a list of all of the hooks that are available to you. Highlight useState, then hit enter to automatically import it from React. The purpose of useState is to handle reactive data. Any data that changes in the application is called state, and when the state changes, you want React to update the UI so the latest changes are reflected to the end user. The hook takes one optional argument, which is the default state, which we'll go ahead and set to 0. The function then returns an array that contains two values you can use within your component. The reason they're returned in an array is because we can destructure them with JavaScript to easily assign the values to local variables that we can name whatever we want. The first value is the reactive data or state. If we then reference it in the UI and its value changes in the future, React will automatically rebuild the UI to show the latest value. It'll start with a value of 0, our default in the hook, but how do we then change its value in the future? The second element in the array is a setter function. For example, we might listen to the onClick event on the button, and when clicked, we'll call the setCount function to increment the count by 1. If we compare this code to a class-based component, you can see it's far more complex. We need a class to extend a React component, then a constructor to initialize the state, and also notice how we're required to reference the this keyword all over the place. useState, in my opinion, is a much cleaner solution. Now we're ready to tackle the second most important hook, useEffect, which also happens to be one of the most confusing. And in order to understand it, you first need to understand the component lifecycle. Here in our old class component, we're implementing methods to handle different lifecycle events. Here's a simplified breakdown of the component lifecycle. The component is added to the UI, or mounted, which can only happen once, then reactive data on the component can change, or it's updated, which can happen multiple times. Then finally, at some point, the component will be removed from the UI or unmounted. Now keep these three lifecycle events or side effects in mind as we talk about the useEffect hook, which allows us to implement logic for all of them from within a single function API. useEffect is a function that takes a function you define as its first argument. React will then run your function or side effect after it has updated the DOM. With the current implementation, it will run this function anytime stateful data changes on the component. That means it'll run once when the component is initialized with the default value, then run again each time the state or count is updated. In most cases, though, you'll likely want more fine-grained control over that behavior. For example, imagine we need to fetch data when the component is first initialized, then update the state asynchronously after the data has been fetched. This code would result in an infinite loop, because every time we do the fetch, we then update the state, which then triggers another fetch, and so on forever. The way we address this is by adding a second argument to useEffect, which is an array of dependencies. If you add an empty array, it means there are no dependencies, which means it will only run once when the component is first initialized. But in other cases, you might want to rerun the function anytime certain stateful data has changed. You can do that by adding the state to the dependencies array. Now React will track that value, and anytime it changes, it will rerun this function. Now, one last thing you might want to do with useEffect is run some teardown code when the component is destroyed. The way we implement a teardown function is to return a function from our useEffect callback. React will take the function returned here, then call it when the component is destroyed. And with that, let's move on to our next hook, useContext. This hook allows you to work with React's Context API, which itself is a mechanism that allows you to share or scope values throughout the entire component tree. Let's imagine we have an object called moods that can be happy or sad. To share the current mood across multiple disconnected components, we can create a context. One part of the application might be happy, so we use a context provider to scope the happy mood there. Now, any child component inside of it can inherit that value without needing to pass props down to the children. And that finally brings us to the useContext hook. It allows us to access or consume the current value from the context provider, which might live many levels higher in the component tree. Reading a parent value with useContext is much easier than passing props down through multiple children. Now, if the mood changes from happy to sad in the parent provider, the value here will be updated automatically. Now, if you've ever used React Context in the past, you've likely used the consumer component. The useContext hook is basically a cleaner replacement for the consumer. And now let's switch gears to useRef. This hook allows you to create a mutable object that will keep the same reference between renders. It can be used when you have a value that changes, kind of like setState, but the difference being that it doesn't trigger a re-render when the value changes. For example, if we tried to build a counter button with useRef, we could reference the current count by calling count.current. However, when we click the button, the count would never change in the UI because useRef doesn't trigger a re-render like setState does. So that can be useful when you need a mutable value. But a more common use case for useRef is to grab HTML elements from the DOM. We can start by creating a null reference called myButton, then connect it to the raw HTML button using the ref attribute. From there, we could reference the HTML button in a function to call native DOM APIs like click in this example, which would programmatically click the button. The bottom line is that when you need to grab an element from the DOM, useRef is the hook you're looking for. The next hook we'll look at is a pretty scary one, useReducer. But what it does is actually very similar to setState. It just goes about it in a different way using the Redux pattern, which works like this. Instead of updating the state directly, you dispatch actions that go to a reducer function, and that reducer function determines how to compute the next state. Now, just like useState, useReducer returns an array of two values, with the first value being the reactive state that you want to show in the UI. The second value is where things get different. Instead of a function that updates the state, you're given a function that can dispatch an action. An action is just an object that has a type, which can be any string you want, and an optional data payload. You might dispatch an action when a button is clicked, which will trigger your reducer function. The reducer function is something you define and pass as the argument to the useReducer hook. The function takes the current state and the action as arguments and uses these two values to compute the next state, which is usually handled inside of a switch statement. In this example, if the action is increment, we add one. If it's decrement, we subtract one. And lastly, I'll point out the hook also takes the initial state as its second argument. Now, you may be wondering why you'd ever want to use code like this, because it looks way more complex than just using setState. The answer, which not everyone will agree with, is that it helps your code manage complexity as it grows. As you add more components to your app, it becomes more difficult to manage state in a reliable and predictable way, and the Redux pattern can help with that. Now we're ready to move on to the useMemo hook, which can help you optimize computation cost for improved performance. But keep in mind that you don't want to prematurely optimize performance. So think of this hook as an opt-in tool to deal with expensive computations that you know are hurting performance. Let's imagine we have a counter again, but then we compute an additional property after that called expensive count that requires some kind of expensive computation. Instead of recomputing on every render, we can memoize the value. We write a function that returns the computed value. Then as a second argument, we add the dependencies to determine when this computation should be run, which in this case would be whenever the count changes. That's great for memoizing return values, but in other cases, you may want to memoize an entire function, in which case you're looking for the use callback hook. When you define a function in a component, a new function object is created each time the component is re-rendered. Usually this isn't a big deal for performance, but in some cases, you may want to memoize the function. A common use case is when you pass the same function down to multiple child components. By wrapping the function in useCallback, we can prevent unnecessary re-renders of the children because they'll always be using the same function object. Now let's switch gears to one of the more confusing hooks, useImperativeHandle. If you build a reusable component library in React, you may need to get access to the underlying DOM element and then forward it so it can be accessed by the consumers of your component library. You can access a native DOM element with the useRef hook that we showed earlier. Then you can wrap the component in forwardRef to make that ref available when someone uses this component. Now, useImperativeHandle comes in if you want to change the behavior of the exposed ref. You might want to modify the methods on the native element, but in reality, the need for this hook is probably pretty rare. And speaking of rare, another hook that you'll rarely need is useLayoutEffect. It works just like the useEffect hook with one small difference. Your callback will run after rendering the component, but before the actual updates have been painted to the screen. That means React will wait for your code to finish running before it updates the UI for the end user. But there may be situations where you need to calculate a scroll position or something else in the UI before the DOM is visually updated. And with that, we've reached the final built-in hook, useDebugValue. But this hook won't make a lot of sense until you start building your own custom hooks from scratch. If you pull up your app in the browser, then open React DevTools, you'll notice that every component in the tree will tell you a little bit about the hooks that are defined there. The purpose of useDebugValue is to make it possible to define your own custom labels here in React DevTools when you start building custom hooks. Let's go ahead and build a custom hook now to see that in action. Notice how our component is using two hooks together. We have useState to define a display name for the user, and then useEffect to fetch that username from the database somewhere. Now let's imagine we have 10 other components that need to implement the same exact logic. The great thing about hooks is that we can easily do that by defining our own function called useDisplayName. It's just a regular JavaScript function that implements the same code we had in our component. The only difference is that we now want to return the display name from this function so we can use it elsewhere in the application. And we can now put it to use in multiple components. One final touch here is to add useDebugValue to our custom hook. The argument passed to the hook will be the value shown in React DevTools. As you can see here, it shows the DisplayName label along with the value, as well as a breakdown of the primitive hooks that went into this custom hook. And with that, we've looked at every single built-in React hook. If this video helped you, please like and subscribe, and consider becoming a pro member to get access to the upcoming React Firebase course. Thanks for watching, and I will see you in the next one.